Welcome, dear students, to our history class of standard 9th. Today we will be doing chapter 2, India, Events After 1960. India became independent in 1947. India accepted the constitutional framework in 1950 and became a sovereign democratic nation. During the initial period after independence, India needed to solve different issues of economic, political, and social development. The establishment of the Planning Commission and emphasis on industrialization was a means to achieve economic development and to eliminate poverty in India. Successful conduct of elections and faith in democratic traditions made it possible for us to achieve political stability. At the same time, several social reforms, including policies and programs for the weaker sections of the society, were sought to be implemented. Goa, Daman, and Diu, situated on the coast of Arabian Sea, were under the Portuguese rule for over 400 years until 1961. In 1961, the Indian government conducted a military invasion in Goa, Daman and Diu to free them from Portuguese rule. On December 19, 1961, Goa, Daman and Diu came under the Indian Constitution. The Sino-Indian War of 1962 is not a happy memory. It is remembered for the humiliation of India's total defeat, the betrayal of Hindi-Chini Bhai Bhai, and the devastating personal blow it dealt Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru. It left us minus large chunks of territory. The conflict stretches back to at least 1914, when representatives from Britain, the Republic of China and Tibet gathered in Shimla, in what is now India, to negotiate a treaty that would determine the status of Tibet and effectively settle the borders between China and British India. The Chinese, balking at proposed terms that would allow Tibet to be autonomous and remain under China's control, refused to sign the deal. But Britain and Tibet signed a treaty establishing what would be called the McMahon Line, named after a British colonial official, Henry McMahon, who proposed the border. India maintains that the McMahon Line, a 550-mile frontier that extends through the Himalayas, is the official legal border between China and India. But China never accepted it. In 1947, India declared its independence from Britain. 2 years later, the Chinese revolutionary Mao Zedong proclaimed an end to his country's communist revolution and founded the People's Republic of China. Almost immediately, the two countries, now the world's most populous, found themselves at odds over the border. Tensions rose throughout the 1950s. The Chinese insisted that Tibet was never independent and could not have signed a treaty creating an international border. There were several failed attempts at peaceful negotiation. By 1962, war had broken out. From October 20, when Chinese launched attacks in the west, that is Aksai Chin, and east, that is Northeast Frontier Agency, today's Arunachal Pradesh, till November 19, when China announced a unilateral ceasefire, the war lasted less than a month, yet ended an era. Provoked by a territorial dispute and tensions over Tibet, the war was brief and China emerged victorious. However, the war still cast a long shadow over Sino-Indian relations. First, the War of 1962 sealed the fate of the Tibet issue as an eternal source of tension in Sino-Indian relations. Second, 1962 had bequeathed to China and India the border dispute that started the war and has made resolving it a Herculean task. Thus, to this day, China continues to claim the Indian state of Arunachal Pradesh. Third, the border war has instilled deep mistrust and a strong sense of rivalry between the two sides. After India became independent, Prime Minister Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru led the country. He was the architect of India's foreign policy. His contribution to the social and economic development of India is significant. When India won its independence, barely 2 years after the World War II, the entire world was still recuperating from the most calamitous war in its history. The world was divided into two belligerent camps that were at odds with each other. Jawaharlal Nehru had inherited a nation of 370 million famished people. The country's economy was in disarray. India's share of the world's health had fallen from about 30% in the mid-18th century to less than 3% when the British left the country in 1947. Against this backdrop, Nehru took over the nation with the hope of forging amicable relationship with the countries of the world. The newly independent nations that emerged in the 1950s and the 1960s became an important factor in changing the balance of power within the United Nations. Under Nehru's guidance, India became the first country to begin a policy that was new in the history of international relations, the policy of non-alignment. Nehru passed away in 1964. Whenever we discuss the simplest personalities in the history of India, former Prime Minister Lal Bahadur Shastri's name comes at the top. His simplicity was the biggest inspiration for the people. Lal Bahadur Shastri succeeded Nehru and became the next Prime Minister of India. Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan was the slogan of the second Prime Minister of India, Lal Bahadur Shastri, in 1965 at a public gathering at Ramlila Maidan in Delhi. Soon after, Shastri took over the Prime Ministership of India after Nehru's death, India was attacked by Pakistan. The 1965 war between India and Pakistan was the second conflict between the two countries over the status of the state of Jammu and Kashmir. At the same time, there was a scarcity of food grains in the country. Shastri gave the slogan Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan to enthuse the soldiers to defend India and simultaneously cheering farmers to do their best to increase the production of food grains to reduce dependence on imports. It became a very popular slogan. Lal Bahadur Shastri's death is still one of the biggest mysteries of Indian politics. He went to Tashkent to sign the Tashkent MOU to end the 1965 war with Pakistan. At that time, he was well, But immediately after that, on the night of 11 January 1966, there was sudden news that he had died of a heart attack. However, the mystery regarding his suspicious death remains to date. Indira Gandhi became the Prime Minister of India in 1966. She was the first and to date only female Prime Minister of India. During her tenure, Pakistan's oppressive policies in East Pakistan resulted in a big movement there. This movement was led by Sheikh Mujibur Rahman and his organization Mukti Bahini. This crisis in East Pakistan affected India as well because millions of refugees came to India. In December 1971, Indira Gandhi sent Indian troops to fight the Pakistan Army in support of the Bangladesh War of Independence. The intervention brought a conclusion to the war in 9 short days, ending a 9-month campaign of genocide and ethnic cleansing that had left countless dead and many millions displaced. In 1971, India won the war against Pakistan that resulted in the birth of Bangladesh, earlier East Pakistan. On that day, Pakistan lost half its country, its forces in the east, and had to publicly surrender to India. It was also the largest military surrender after World War II. India conducted its first nuclear detonation, described by India as a peaceful nuclear explosion, on 18 May 1974. A referendum on abolishing the monarchy was held in the Kingdom of Sikkim on 14 April 1975. It was approved by 97.55% of voters and resulted in the country becoming an Indian state. It is widely believed that the Allahabad High Court's decision, which came on June 12, 1975, led to the imposition of the emergency. On 26 June 1975, the then Prime Minister Indira Gandhi took to the radio to announce that the President had proclaimed the emergency. The then President Fakhruddin Ali Ahmed, at the behest of Indira Gandhi, declared the emergency on 25 June 1975 under Article 352 of the Constitution. But what led to the imposition of the emergency in the country? It is widely believed that the Allahabad High Court's decision, which came 13 days before the emergency was declared, led to the decision. Raj Narayan, who was defeated by Indira Gandhi in 1971 Lok Sabha elections in Rae Bareli, moved the High Court saying Indira misused the government machinery to win the election. The court, in its judgment on 12 June 1975, barred Indira from contesting elections and holding any position for 6 years. Indira filed an appeal in the Supreme Court against the High Court's judgment. The Apex Court upheld the judgment, but it allowed her to continue as the Prime Minister. In the wake of the Apex's court judgment, Jayaprakash Narayan urged people to organize protest in order to demand Indira's resignation from the Prime Minister's post. Following the appeal of Jayaprakash Narayan, widespread protests started taking place across the country under the leadership of likes of Morarji Desai and Jayaprakash Narayan. In view of the protest and constant pressure from the opposition, Indira decided to impose the emergency, which ended on 21st March 1977. Finally, Indira had to give up her post of the Prime Minister and Morarji Desai became the Prime Minister at the age of 81. Morarji Desai, the fourth Prime Minister of India, led India's first non-Congress government from 1977 to 1979. After becoming the Prime Minister of a Janata Party government on 24th March 1977, He had promised to end poverty in 10 years and outlaw alcohol. But he had to resign and his government fell after 28 months in office as a revolt brimmed against him in the Janata Party. Chaudhary Charan Singh served as the fifth Prime Minister of India between 28 July 1979 to 14 January 1980. Historians and people alike frequently refer to him as the champion of India's presence. Elections were conducted once again in 1980 and the Congress Party under the leadership of Indira Gandhi came to power again. During this decade, the Indian political system faced many challenges. The Khalistan movement is a Sikh separatist movement seeking to create a homeland for Sikhs by establishing a sovereign state called Khalistan, that is land of the Khalsa in the Punjab region. In the 1980s, a violent sectionist movement to create Khalistan paralyzed Punjab for a decade. This was led most effectively by Jarnail Singh Bhindranwale. For nearly 5 days, the Indian Army used heavy artillery, tanks and helicopters to remove Jarnail Singh Bhindranwale, who was demanding the establishment of Khalistan, a Sikh homeland, from inside the Golden Temple in Amritsar. This was Operation Blue Star. The collateral damage, including the death of many pilgrims as well as damage to the Akal Takht. The military action on the sacred temple was criticized by Sikhs, both inside and outside India. Indian Prime Minister Indira Gandhi was assassinated on 31st October 1984 at her residence in Safdarjung Road, New Delhi. She was killed by her bodyguards in the aftermath of the Operation Blue Star. The United Liberation Front of Assam, ULFA, is an extremist organization reportedly formed in 1979 in the northeastern Indian state of Assam. The group was thought to be formed by a few Assamese rebels with the purpose of forming a separate country of Assam independent of Indian rule. Rajiv Gandhi was an Indian politician who served as the 6th Prime Minister of India from 1984 to 1989. He took office after the 1984 assassination of his mother, Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, to become the youngest Indian Prime Minister at the age of 40 and perhaps one of the youngest elected heads of government in the world. Besides being the harbinger of a generational change in the country, Mr. Gandhi received the biggest mandate in the nation's history. For no one could have ascended to power, becoming both Prime Minister and Congress President in more tragic and tormenting circumstances than Mr. Gandhi did in the wake of Indira Gandhi's brutal assassination on 31st October 1984. But he wore the awesome burden of personal grief and national responsibility with remarkable poise, dignity, and restraint. A modern-minded, decisive, but undemonstrative man, Mr. Gandhi was at home in the world of high technology. And as he had repeatedly said, one of his main objectives, besides preserving India's unity, was to propel it into the 21st century. He tried to make several reforms in the fields of Indian economy and that of science and technology. He took the lead in solving the issues of Tamil minority in Sri Lanka. He promoted the idea of a united Sri Lanka with internal autonomy to the Tamil community, but his efforts in this regard proved to be in vain. The corruption scam, which led to the fall of Rajiv Gandhi-led Congress government in 1989, related to alleged kickbacks in the 1,437 crore howitzer gun deal signed in 1986 with Swedish arms manufacturer Bofors. It was alleged that the Swedish company paid nearly 64 crore as a bribe to politicians, Congress leaders and bureaucrats. Former Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi was also implicated in the case. The Bofors scandal was a major issue that was highlighted in the subsequent elections, which led to the Congress losing power. Several political parties formed a coalition called the Janata Dal, and Vishwanath Pratap Singh becomes the 7th Prime Minister of India. Vishwanath Pratap Singh was a politician who ushered in India the silent revolution by empowering the underclass, especially the other backward caste. He could not continue as Prime Minister due to internal differences in the party. It is one of the rare moments in Indian politics when one rose directly to become the Prime Minister. But then Chandrasekhar was a rarity. He was a decisive leader. Had he got the mandate, he would have proved to be one of the best ever Prime Ministers. His government was also short-lived. Security analysts believed that Rajiv Gandhi, a popular politician, did not take threats against him seriously. He was on the hit list of the terrorist. In 1991, during the election campaign, the terrorist organization in Sri Lanka, Liberation Tigers of Tamil Eelam, LTTE, assassinated Rajiv Gandhi. It was the cold, bitter and terrifying night of January 1990 when the life of Kashmiri Pandits spiraled into one of the worst nightmares in the valley. In the midst of political rivalries and militant insurgency, the Kashmiri Pandits, the Hindu minority community in the valley, were driven out in one of the most unprecedented exoduses in India's history. Their plight is an intricate and difficult one to tell. One that is rife with murders, grenade blasts, encounters, arrests, disappearances, myriad slogans in favor of freedom from India for Pakistan, in favor of extremists and against Pandit's brethren. This problem grew serious day by day, and today it has taken the form of terrorism. So, dear students, today we have covered the events that happened in India in 1960s, 1970s and 1980s. We will continue with the lesson in our next video. That's all for this class. Thanks for watching.